Good morning. It's good to see you this morning. I want to invite you to stand as we open our time of worship this morning. We're singing hymn number 546, Love Lifted Me. Welcome you again to worship this morning, whether you're here in the worship center or you're joining us online. We're so glad you're here this morning. Two quick announcements before we jump in. In a couple of weeks, we're going to be feeding about 500 people with Moments of Hope. The donation board and volunteer sign-up sheets are out in the commons, so stop by there, take a sticky note. Donations are due back to the church by Tuesday, February 27th. And then the only last announcement, this Wednesday night, the menu for supper is pizza, salad, peaches, and dessert. Sounds amazing. All right, let's go to the Lord in prayer. Lord, we thank you so much for the opportunity that you give us to be in your house today with this family of faith. Lord, as we get started today, we pray that you would help us to quiet the outside noise in our minds and our hearts. And focus completely and totally on you so we can listen to what you have to say today. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
Good morning. In just a minute, I'm going to ask you to stand, but just really quickly, I'll probably be giving this announcement for a while just to make sure that everyone knows, but we've added a microphone and a stand on the floor for anyone that wants to read scripture but doesn't necessarily want to come up these steps. You're more than welcome to. You're more than welcome to come up these steps if you want to, but if you'd rather stay down there, that'll be there and we can unmute it when it's time for you to read scripture. So I'll probably be saying that a few times and you'll get tired of hearing it, so I apologize, but I just want you to know that. Would you please stand if you're able, and let's sing.
Like David shepherd boy, made him a king. I'm gonna trust you, Lord, and give you everything.
I'll be a conqueror, 'cause you'll fight for me. I'll be a champion, claiming your victory. Give me faith like Daniel in the lion's den. Give me hope like Moses in the wilderness. Give me a heart like David, Lord, be my defense. I can face my giants with confidence.
I'm gonna sing and shout and shake the wall. Won't stop until I see them fall. Stand up, step out when you call, Jesus, Jesus. I'm gonna sing and shout and shake the wall. Won't stop until I see them fall. I'm gonna stand up, step out when you call, Jesus. Give me faith like Daniel in the lion's den. Give me hope like Moses in the wilderness. A heart like David, Lord, be my defense, so I can face my giants with confidence. Give me faith like Daniel in the lion's den. Give me hope like Moses in the wilderness. Give me a heart. Confidence.
Amen. You may be seated.
All right, so I know where all the sound went. They went to this microphone, not to mine. All right, I've got some stuff to show you this morning. Very different things, but they all share something in common, okay? So I want to see if y'all can figure that out. Does anybody know what this is? You think you know? Yes, it does. It goes to the air in the house. In fact, in my house, I put this in one of the vents. What do we call it? Well, it goes kind of in the air conditioner, but this is an air filter. Okay? So if it's an air filter, and if you look at it, basically the air can blow through this, right? But it catches dust in the air and other things that we don't want to breathe. And so if I put this in my air conditioner at home, in my system, after a few months, it's full of lint and dust and stuff. So it gets really dirty, but it catches it. So it filters out the bad stuff. Now, I'll give you an easy one. Who knows what that is? This is a coffee filter. Ooh, you see something in common? Filter, right? Okay. So if you put this in a coffee maker and you put coffee grounds, now, I'm actually not a coffee drinker, but a lot of people, I expected that reaction from the adults, not the children. Well, I know a lot of people who love coffee, including our daughters, they do, and they love to drink the coffee. Do they love to drink the grounds? Oh, no, if you drink it, get a mouthful of coffee grounds, that would be yuck. So you filter out the stuff you don't want to drink, and you let the good coffee go through. And so that's what the filter does. It catches the bad stuff, or the stuff you don't want to drink. go for this one. Any idea what that is? Something that ends with filter, she said. Our kids are catching on. Yes, this is actually a water filter. It is. This goes in our refrigerator because our refrigerator sends water to like the ice maker, you know, and so it goes through, and we have pretty clean water that comes into our house, but still there might be some different kind of chemicals or something in the water, and it filters that out, and it catches the bad stuff, all right? Doesn't let it through, so we just get the good, clean water. And then the last one, it's an oil filter. You are right. This goes on a car, right? Like this, and so you have an oil filter on the car because a car needs to have oil to make the engine run smooth. And sometimes the oil gets like dirt and stuff, even like little bits of metal in it and things that could make your engine stop. And so the filter catches that. So it catches the bad stuff, lets the good stuff through. So you may wonder, why am I showing you all these different kinds of filters? And yes, there are lots of other kinds of filters as well. The reason is that God calls us to filter things out from the world, meaning you could be at school, and I know that you know none of your classmates would do anything like this, and none of you would do something like this, but what if someone started saying bad words, and you heard that? Did you want to say, oh, I'm going to go home and use those words, and I'm going to say bad words? No. You filter it out. You say, oh, he shouldn't have said that, you know. And so even though I heard it, I'm not going to use it. You know, I'm not going to make that a part of my life. Or if you see somebody who's mean, they're unkind. They say, maybe they make fun of someone. And you say, oh, I saw them do that, but I don't want to do that. So I'm not going to copy them because Jesus tells me to be kind to people. What you're doing is you're filtering. You're saying, oh, those are things that are bad for me and they're bad for other people. And so God helps us to filter out the bad from the good. And so I'm going to read you a verse. Where did I put my... Oh, thank you. All right. Here's a verse from Philippians. And it has to do with you know, when you filter out, you say, okay, I've learned what's bad. I'm not going to make that a part of my life. I just want what's good. And the Apostle Paul said this. He said, he says, finally, whatever is true. Now, are things that are true, is that good for things to be true rather than lies? Yeah, so true is a good thing. Whatever's true, whatever's noble, that's a nice word. Whatever's right, whatever's pure, whatever's lovely, whatever's admirable, if anything is excellent or praiseworthy, think about such things. So the Apostle Paul is saying, you know, there's a lot of bad in the world, but don't put your mind on all those bad things. Think about the things that are good. And if you put those things in your mind and in your heart, then also good things are going to come out of your mouth. Good things are going to come out of your hands when you're helping people. And so I just want you to be aware that God has given you a filter. He's given you a filter in your mind and in your heart. And he will help you use it in order to get the good things, the blessed things that he wants to be in your life. So let's just pray for God's help in that, okay? Let's pray. Heavenly Father, I thank you that even though we live in a world where there's a lot of bad that goes on, you give us wisdom to know how to filter out the bad and not to make it a part of our lives. So just help us to do that, to be brave and strong, to be kind and forgiving and loving. I pray in Jesus' name, amen. All right, thank you. You may go back to your families.
Okay, we're reading from Psalm 51, 1 through 10. Have mercy on me, O God, according to your unfailing love, according to your great compassion, blot out my transgressions. Wash away all my iniquity and cleanse me from my sin. For I know my transgressions, and my sin is always before me. Against you, you only, have I sinned and done what is evil in your sight, so that you are proved right when you speak and justified when you judge. Surely I was sinful at birth, sinful from the time my mother conceived me.
Surely you desire truth in the inner parts. You teach me wisdom in the innermost place. Cleanse me with hyssop, and I will be clean. Wash me, and I will be whiter than snow. Let me hear joy and gladness. Let the bones you have crushed rejoice. Hide your face from my sins, and blot out all my iniquity. Create in me a pure heart, O God, and renew a steadfast spirit within me.
I just want to speak the name of Jesus over every heart and every mind, 'cause I know there is peace within your presence. I speak Jesus. I just want to speak the name of Jesus till every dark addiction starts to break, declaring there is hope and there is freedom. I speak Jesus. Your name is power. Your name.
Break every stronghold, shine through.
There we go. You know, as we continue our journey through the New Testament book of Colossians, we're ready to move on into the third chapter. And I know what y'all are thinking, what? All this time and we're just to chapter three? Yeah, it's gonna pick up pace, really. My Bible gives this particular passage that we're gonna look at in chapter three the caption. I know some of your Bibles have that, and in mine it says, Rules for Holy Living. So you might keep that in mind. So I want to share with you then from the book of Colossians chapter 3, starting at verse 1. It says, Since then you have been raised with Christ, set your hearts on things above, where Christ is seated at the right hand of God. Set your mind on things above, not on earthly things. For you died, and your life is now hidden with Christ in God. When Christ, who is your life, appears, then you will appear with him in glory. Put to death, therefore, whatever belongs to your earthly nature: sexual immorality, impurity, lust, evil desires and greed, which is idolatry. Because of these, the wrath of God is coming. You used to walk in these ways in the life you once lived. But now you must rid yourselves of all such things as these: anger, rage, malice, slander, and filthy language from your lips. Do not lie to each other, since you have taken off your old self with its practices and have put on the new self, which is being renewed in the knowledge, renewed in knowledge in the image of its creator. Here there is no Greek or Jew, circumcised or uncircumcised, barbarian, Scythian, slave or free, but Christ is all and is in all. Now, the Apostle Paul has been helping the believers in Colossae to understand that for successful Christian living, meaning a life that pleases God and brings glory to God, well, your life needs to experience a change, not just in theory, but in practical matters. Practical matters like your attitude and your desires and your behaviors. And he uses phrases like, you used to, meaning your old life was like this, but now in your new life, you need to be like this. And he talks in verses 9 and 10 that we just read about taking off and putting on, introducing then the metaphor of clothing or of garments. And I'm going to take these two closely related concepts of taking off and putting on, and I'm going to deal with them separately today and then next Sunday. So today from the passage we just read is the topic of undressing for successful Christian living. Things that you need to remove from your life in order to be the kind of person God intends. And then next Sunday, we will move on to the kind of the positive side, the next step of dressing for success. Paul says, therefore, as God's chosen people, holy and loved, clothe yourselves with dot, dot, dot. And so he lists for us things that need to be part of our lives as Christians. But let's start where Paul did. In verse 8, where the NIV, a New International Version, says, now you must rid yourselves of all of these. It more literally says, you must take off or put off or lay aside all of these things. And this was common language of what they would use for a soiled garment, something that you would want to take off, get rid of, or at least to wash. And of course, he's not talking about clothes at all. In the Bible, you find that garments are often symbolic of your conduct, of your attitudes, of your behavior. On the positive side, there are verses like Job 29:14 that says, I put on righteousness as my clothing. Justice was my robe and my turban. And Isaiah 11:5 that says, righteousness will be his belt and faithfulness the sash around his waist. On the negative side, you can find verses like Psalm 35:26 that says, let all who exalt themselves over me, and this would be God speaking, let all who exalt themselves over me be clothed with shame and disgrace. You might remember the practice of people in the Bible putting on sackcloth, kind of a burlap. And it was a symbolic, external way of showing that there was sorrow, that there was even sadness in a person's soul. Now, not too long ago, I'd been out working in the yard and in the garden, kind of cleaning it up, you know, for the fall. And it had been raining, so things were muddy. And by the time I had pulled up the last of the weeds and cut the last of the shrubs, I was covered by mud and I was covered by sawdust and stuff like that. To finish the job, I had to load all the refuse into my trailer, did a couple of trips down to the landfill or to the dump to get rid of it. And when I got back home, I realized that everything I had been touching was just gross. The seat of my car was muddy and dirty. The steering wheel had the prints of my hands on it. Light switches that I touched, doorknobs, everything had become soiled because I was soiled. At the end of the project, I walked into our laundry room to put off those garments. I didn't go to hug my wife first. I didn't go to sit at the lunch table with the family. I knew that those things had to come off, and I needed to have a shower and to be made clean and new. Now, this is just common sense to us. But how often do people, even Christian people, carry around with them the filth of the world? And without a second thought, they spread it, I might say we spread it, to anybody that we come in contact with. This can happen in different ways. It can happen through the filthy language or the dirty jokes or stories that we've heard. And when that goes in and then comes back out, we're doing nothing but sharing the filth. It's become a part of the garment that we're wearing. To tell lies or to be deceitful towards people, to hold prejudice and to belittle others with our comments, to be angry at people and to have bad attitudes and bad moods. All of this is something that can envelop us. There's an old trope or illustration, oftentimes called kicking the cat or kicking the dog. You might be familiar with this. It's basically, you know, the scenario of, you know, there's a boss at work who's upset because the sales numbers are down or something like that, and he's upset, so he just gets all over the case of his employee, runs him up and down, leaving his employee in a bad mood. That guy goes home. His wife greets him at the door, and he snaps at her, leaving her in a bad mood. So she yells at the kids and looks at the mess that they've made around the house, and she sends the kids to their rooms. And the little boy now is in a bad mood. He doesn't understand what he did. He's walking to his room, and there's the cat. He's in such a bad mood, he kicks the cat. And the cat's like, what did I do? But that is certainly the way these harmful attitudes, these harmful behaviors get spread and affect those around us. The sinful nature that we carry around with us, often, as I said, wrapped in like a cloak, it causes more damage than we can imagine. Now, I know this would never happen here at Brothers Church, but there are places. There are places where church members would come together into their Sunday school classes on Sunday morning, and somebody's in a bad mood, and they began to share their complaints and or their gossip about people, and it stirs up everybody, bitterness and old grudges, until the soil, the attitudes of everybody who's there, it's soiled. And so does that help you to understand why Paul paints the picture here and says, guess what? There are some things that need to be taken out, taken off of your life. Now, I'm going to share with you some of the things that Paul said must be laid aside from the Christian life. I'm not going to spend a lot of time on these. One, there's too many to spend a lot of time. But the other is you kind of know what these things are. So it doesn't take a lot of definition here. First thing is that Paul focuses on sins of sensuality. Now, he's picking out some things that were major issues in the Greek and Roman society, and some of them even in the Jewish society, but none of this is alien to us. We understand this stuff well. He says you need to undress yourself of immorality and impurity. Verse 5, this is just a repeat of what I read a moment ago. Put to death, therefore, whatever belongs to your earthly nature: sexual immorality, impurity, lust, evil desires, and greed, which is idolatry. When Paul says put to death, it has the same meaning of take it off and get rid of it. The word immorality from the Greek is porneia. Not a big stretch for us to understand that we get our word pornography, which is a depiction of immorality. We get it from that Greek word. Some versions use words like fornication or uncleanness and indecency. And it covers a wide span of different behaviors. But I think of the words of the Supreme Court Justice Potter Stewart when they were debating, you know, what was pornography and how you define it. And he says, well, it's hard to define, but you know it when you see it. Well, we do. We know those kind of things that defile us inwardly before there's even any kind of outward defiling. A unique and defining virtue of Christianity is sexual purity. For much of the ancient world, the appetite for sensual pleasure, it was something to be gratified in whatever way possible. Whether it was before marriage or during marriage or extramarital, it was not seen as something to be controlled. You were supposed to act on your urges. Marital faithfulness and personal purity, they were not given all that much thought. And the boundaries of permissiveness were constantly being pushed. Not so different than our culture today. But a brief survey of the Bible and of human history and of our present-day society helps us to understand the harm that comes when people misuse God's beautiful gift of sexual attraction and fulfillment. When it's misused, it leads to selfishness, to broken trust and broken relationships. It leads to diseases, unfulfilled responsibilities, guilt, and pain. This promiscuous behavior was actually a major factor in the fall of the Roman Empire. Now, please keep in mind here that Satan doesn't create anything. He is not the creator. All Satan does is to take something good and to corrupt it, to pervert it. Satan takes the beautiful and purposeful attraction between a man and a woman designed for the long-term propagation and the joy and the fulfillment of the human race, and he corrupts it into something selfish and fleeting. God's instructions about purity, they're not arbitrary rules that God made up to suck the fun out of our lives. He didn't give us these rules just to see if we would obey them, but rather God is looking out for our good. Paul taught that our bodies are temples to be consecrated, to be dedicated to God. So paired with the immorality and impurity, he includes lust and evil desires. And you may say, well, isn't that just the same stuff? Well, this actually describes the heart condition, the lust and the evil desires. Lust describes a person who's a slave to his or her passions, while the Greek word epithumia means to desire things that are wrong. These are things that must be taken off and put out of the Christian life. Well, you may say, well, you know, it's one thing to control our behavior, to say, well, I want to do that, but I'm not going to do that. But how is it that I can control my thoughts and my desires? I think the great reformer Martin Luther probably had the best statement. Many of us have heard it. He says, you can't stop a bird from flying over your head, but you can stop it from making a nest in your hair. Which means things are going to pop into our minds, thoughts that aren't pure, and we can't always stop that. It just happens. What you do with it then is the mark of your faith in Christ. Are you going to dwell on it? Are you going to let it become a part of your thought process, which is then going to lead to behaviors? Or are you going to say, no, I'm going to focus on the things that are good and right and pure and noble and lovely? So learn to recognize evil desires and make the decision not to dwell on them. So related to evil desires, Paul also mentions greed, or we might use another word, covetousness. This is the Greek pleonexia, the desire to have more. Isn't that greed? The desire always to have more. And this is not the innocent desire of a person who, you know, thinks that they would like to get a promotion at work and a raise. Or it's not talking about the wise considerations for making investments, you know, to get a better return on your money. It's talking about a sinful desire for what other people have. It's selfish at its core. When involving things, it can lead to robbery or thievery. When involving power, it can lead to ruthlessness. When involving people, it easily leads to sexual sins. Greed is a distorted view of the things that are important in life. Greed makes a god out of earthly things. That's why Paul talks, he says there that it's a form of idolatry. It becomes idolatry when we give greater attention or greater allegiance to things than to the one true God. It's certainly a prevalent form of idolatry in our world today. But then, going back to the passage to verse 8, here are some more of the vices that Paul deals with. He says, but now you must rid yourselves of all such things as these: anger, rage, malice, slander, and filthy language from your lips. Paul employs at least two different words for what we would call getting mad. I think of the old story of a man who got on a train from New York City, you know, coming down toward toward Richmond. And when he got on the train, he told the porter there in the sleeper car, he said, you know, I need to get off in Richmond, but I'm really tired. I'm going to take a nap. So when we get to Richmond, I need you to make sure I get off the train. Now, I'm just going to tell you, I'm grumpy when I wake up. And so I may argue with you or not want to, you know, get up, but you need to get me up and off the train. So in the journey somewhere along, let's say, North Carolina, the man wakes up. He comes out, you know, into the hall of the train, and he tracks down the porter, and he is just hopping mad. He blesses him out for letting him sleep through the Richmond stop. And so finally the man just stomps off back to the room. And another porter has watched this exchange, and he came to the first porter, and he said, you know, I think that's the angriest passenger I have ever seen. And the first porter said, no, the angriest passenger I've ever seen was the one I threw off the train in Richmond. We all know, you know, there are different types of anger. Paul here uses the word orge, which describes kind of a slow-burning, long-lasting fire. And so we would describe this as being like bitterness or resentment in our hearts. And then he also uses the term thumos for rage or a fit of temper, like a flash fire. It's easily ignited, but it also then might burn out quickly. Now, the Bible says that you could actually be angry and not sin. But I think it's really referring there to a righteous anger that is controlled, and it leads to positive action. And so if you are angry that there are children going to bed hungry at night, and so you collect food and bring it to give to families that need it, that anger that you felt that in your community there are people going hungry, it's accomplished something godly, something good. But the Bible also says that the anger of men, that tends to be selfish and also tends to be out of control, it does not accomplish the righteousness of God. So both orge and thumos can kill a relationship, can kill a friendship, can kill a marriage. One tends to do it quickly, and the other tends to do it more slowly, but they are both very effective killers. Neither has any place in the Christian life. Some years ago, an author for Reader's Digest was doing some research in order to write an article on kind of the Amish way of living, the Amish people. And in his observations, he went and he did interviews and stuff, and he went to a schoolyard of a school for the Amish children, and he noted that the children never seemed to scream and yell at each other. And this amazed him. And he went and he spoke to the schoolmaster, and he remarked how he had not heard one Amish child yell. And asked the schoolmaster, you know, why is that so? And the schoolmaster replied, well, have you ever heard an Amish adult yell? You wonder how these things get spread? They do, for the good and the bad. And it's just a reminder to me, I think, that it is possible to put off anger, to put off rage, to not let that be a guiding force in your life. He also talks about getting rid of malice. And malice is a vicious attitude that gives birth to a lot of destructive deeds. What makes malice particularly evil is that it's a conscious desire, a want to do harm to somebody. It has no place in the Christian life. Then the next three sins all have to do with language or speech. He talks about slander, which can also be translated as blasphemy. It's insulting lies. We define blasphemy usually as a purposeful lying about God and the things of God. Slander is when you lie to hurt another person. It has no place in Christian speaking or Christian writing. It has no place even in our thoughts. And then he talks about filthy language. All right, once again, don't need to define that. We know what obscenities are. When I hear obscenities, I usually think, this is a lazy use of language. It's inflammatory talk. People often use obscene language when trying to be funny or maybe trying to act tough. Amber will remember this, but many years ago, we got kind of a prank phone call at our house, back when we still had the landline. And it was pretty easy to identify the voice as being probably a young boy, all right, a child. And it just seemed that he was trying to use all the curse words he had learned, you know, he had heard, and any dirty names he had heard, and just trying to fit those in, you know, over the phone to some stranger. Well, we just simply hung up, of course. But then just a minute or so later, the phone rang again, and maybe against better judgment, we answered it again. But this time, it was a woman's voice. And she said, "I believe my son just called you, and I think he has something he needs to say to you." And then that little boy's voice, much more sheepish this time, came on and said, "Okay, I'm sorry for the things I said to you." And the mother came out and said, "Do you accept his apology?" And we're like, "Well, yes, we do." And of course, then I just had to smile, thinking some mother was on the prowl. The kid was in the back room with the phone, man, cursing over the phone, and the mom hears it, comes and hits redial and says, "You apologize." But then I thought, you know, that little boy is now probably in his 30s. And I hope he learned that this is not what you want to wrap yourself in. I tell you what else I hope. I hope he is teaching his children to put away that kind of talk and that kind of attitude. Paul also throws in here lying, deception. And I realize, you know, folks often say, "Oh, I don't tell lies that hurt anyone," but I will just warn you, and you know, we can debate what a white lie is, but a person who takes even white lies lightly finds himself or herself becoming colorblind after a while. Jesus said, "Let your yea be yea and your nay be nay." Paul said, verse 9, "Do not lie to one another, since you have taken off the old self with its practices." James, the brother of Jesus, taught the early Christians that the tongue was a very small but a very powerful part of the body, and that if you can't control what you say, your relationship with God isn't what you think it is. The lordship of Christ includes lordship over our tongues. And then finally, Paul tells us to take off our prejudices. And you may say, "Well, where that passage was prejudice? I don't see that." Well, if you go to verse 11, this is the topic. Paul says, "There is no Greek or Jew, circumcised or uncircumcised, barbarian or Scythian, a slave or free, but Christ is all and is in all." What Paul knew was already happening in the New Testament church, even in those days, was that there was favoritism based on class, sometimes based on race, and it was plaguing the church. And so if you look in Galatians 3:28, he also mentions male nor female there, speaking against gender discrimination. And we could add rich or poor, black or white. These kind of things, these prejudices and favoritisms, plague the church and society. For unity and health within the body of Christ, prejudices and favoritism must be removed from among the fellowship of believers, taken out of our hearts for good. But then the big question after going through that long list is, yeah, but how do we do it? We live in a world where all of this exists. We experience it. We see it every day. So how is it that we are able to get rid of these things that are harmful to our lives? How do we undress ourselves of things that are ingrained in our lives, things that we see practiced around us every day? How do we conquer immorality and lust? How do we free ourselves from greed? How do we control our anger and our tongues? How do we rid our minds of prejudices that maybe have been ingrained in us since birth? The answer is found in the first part of the passage we read. Paul gave the answer before he ever gave them the challenge. He said at verse 1, "Since then you have been raised with Christ, set your hearts on things above, where Christ is seated at the right hand of God. Set your heart on heavenly things." And then he says, "Set your minds on things above, not on earthly things. For you died." Meaning when you gave your life to Christ, you died to yourself, and your life is now hidden with Christ in God. I was just talking about this in our Broadest 101 session. The baptism motif is that we die to ourselves and to the things of this world in order to live through Christ and in Christ. You can't have new life with Christ without agreeing to let him put to death the old life. In 2 Corinthians 5:17, it says, "Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation," or "the new creation has come. The old is gone, the new is here." Christ helps us to set our minds on things above. And when faced with an opportunity like immorality, the Holy Spirit helps us to consider, does this accomplish anything good? Is there anything of eternal value in this? Or is this going to be destructive to my relationships? When faced with the desire to lash out in anger, the Spirit helps us to ask ourselves, would Jesus have ever said what I'm about to say? It's not easy to take off and to throw away the garments of sin that we are so used to, and quite frankly, we're so comfortable with. But for successful Christian living, it's a necessity. We can't patch up old garments. It's time to clothe ourselves with Christ. And we can thank God that Jesus has made this transformation possible for us. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we know that while we are in this world, we will struggle against the things of the world, but we are not helpless. We are not helpless because we have a Lord and Savior. We are not helpless because you have sent your Spirit to live in us and through us. And so, Heavenly Father, we ask your help to find those areas of life. Reveal that to us through your wisdom, but help us to find those things that need to be removed, that need to cease to be a part of our thought process, or the things that we do, or the things that we say. And then, Lord, help in that victory for us not to have any pride, but rather in humility to be able to be a help and a guide to others. I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
together. Lord, we thank you so much for this time of worship that you've given us, for the family of faith that you've given us to share it with. Lord, we also thank you for the message today, and we pray that you would search our hearts and help us to identify those places in our lives where the world has gotten a hold of us, to rid ourselves of it, and instead to focus our minds and hearts on things above so that we can work towards becoming who you would intend for us to be. We love you, and we thank you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.